So cartilage is an elastic material. So this cartilage is found, it forms the skeleton of sharks and some of the fishes. And even in humans, in our body also, we find cartilage in different parts, like tip of our nose. So this part is made up of cartilage, which is flexible. And even the external ear is also made up of cartilage. So tip of our nose, external ear is made up of cartilage, and we have cartilage in our trachea, our windpipe has got C-shaped cartilaginous rings. If that cartilaginous rings are not there, the windpipe, it get collapsed, we cannot breathe in or breathe out. So the windpipe, it needs some support to keep open always. It should be kept open. But here the pressure always changes when we inhale the air, when we exhale the air. So there is a change in pressure. So there is a chance of collapsing of trachea. The trachea is not collapsed. It is supported by C-shaped cartilaginous rings. And even this cartilage is found in the joints of our bones. Our bones have joints, elbow joint, knee joint, hip joint. At these joints, cartilage is found there and it connects different bones. So that is the function of the cartilage in our body. So next we go to the another connective tissues, tendons and ligaments. So the next, tendons and ligaments. So if you see a human, here we find a joint in the elbow. So from here, so we find the bones of our hand inside like this. Here we have a joint in the upper hand bone and in the lower hand two bones. So here is a joint. This joint is formed by ligaments. So the ligaments, they join two different bones. So ligament is also another type of connective tissue, which is made up of fibers, which are very elastic in nature. So these fibers are used to attach two different bones. Even here you see the wrist bones are attached to each other by bands of ligaments. So ligaments. Here, if you see the upper hand, here we have bicep muscle. This is the muscle. So the muscle is attached to the bone by some white color elastic fiber like material, that is tendon. So tendons are the connective tissue fibers which attach the muscle to the bone. Tendons attach muscle to the bone or bone to muscle. Ligaments attach two bones together. So two bones together, they are attached or jointed by ligaments. Muscle is attached to the bone by tendons. So both the tissues, the ligament and tendons, both are very elastic in nature. And they are made up of elastic fibers, and those fibers are made up of a material called as collagen. So collagen is the material by which these elastic fibers of these ligaments and tendons are made. So because of that strong elasticity, they keep our bones in position, so which help us to lift the heavy weights, do the heavy work. That is all because of the elasticity of these tendons and collagens, which attach the bones and muscles together and let us perform the action. So in this animal tissues, we move on to the another type of connective tissue, that is blood. So blood is also a kind of connective tissue which connects different parts of our body. There are so many parts. So all these parts are connected by the blood. Blood always travels from one part to another part, carrying various substances. So the blood, it makes a flow, a continuous stream, which carry the water, minerals, nutrients and waste materials throughout our blood. So blood is in the liquid form. It is a liquid tissue, liquid connective tissue. So we can define the blood as a red, thick, liquid connective tissue, which is found in animals. So the blood is made up of two major components like plasma and cells. There are no fibers as like in other connective tissues. In other connective tissues, we have seen that fibers, they play a major role in keeping different parts connected together. Here, blood in this case connecting, in the sense it is not binding, but it is making a connection between different organs. That is, it is flowing from one organ to another organ and carrying so many different nutrients, water, hormones, enzymes and waste materials like urea, etc. So the blood is mainly divided into two parts, plasma and cells. So the cell part is also called as hematocrit, the cellular part. So there are different kind of cells, red blood cells and white blood cells and platelets. So these are the different types of cells present in blood. Whereas plasma, what is this plasma? Plasma is the fluid part of the blood. Plasma, it contains different substances, but the major part is water. So water is the main content of the plasma. So along with water, it contains glucose, it contains amino acids, and it contains minerals, and it contains enzymes and hormones. It contains enzymes and hormones. It also contains the waste or excretory materials like urea, uric acid, lactic acid, so on. So these are the different types of materials that are found in plasma of our blood. So the cells, they perform different function. So the different types of cells are found in this connective tissue blood. Each cell performs a specific function. Red blood cells, they perform the function of carrying oxygen to different parts. White blood cells, they perform defensive function. They help the body to fight against the disease-causing organisms by different means. And whereas the platelets, they help in the process of blood clotting. Here in the plasma also, there is a special substance called heparin, which helps in the process of blood clotting. In the same way, in the cellular part also, there are some components which help in the process of blood clotting. Because the blood, it flows in a stream, in the channels, blood vessels. So if there is any cut, there is a chance of blood going out of the system, that circulatory system. So naturally what happens is that if we lose our blood, it leads to death. So the blood should not be lost and it should be immediately stopped to flow out. So that is done by the platelets. So platelets, they make a blood clot and they stop the outflow of the blood. And for that process, the other substance that is found in the plasma, that is heparin, is also useful. So that in animals, the human circulatory system is very complex. And that circulatory system, the blood plays a major role. The blood is pumped or circulated throughout our body through a powerful heart. So the heart, it circulates nearly 36,000 liters of blood per day. This 36,000 liters of blood is traveled to a distance of nearly 20,000 kilometers in 24 hours. So the distance, number of times it is circulated, if you count the total distance, it will be around some 20,000 kilometers. So at that level, the blood is transported, circulated throughout our body. So the blood, it is carrying different kind of components in the liquid form, or the liquid part of the blood, that is the plasma. And the blood cells, they are transported throughout, and they are also having different functions. So generally blood is in red color. In most of the mammals, that is in vertebrates also, the blood is in red color. There are some exceptions. In few cases, the blood is not in red color. In case of a snail, the blood is not in red color, it is in blue color. In case of a cockroach, the blood is not red in color, it is white in color. So we know that the color of the blood is because of the pigment. Our blood is red in color because of the pigment hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is the red color pigment which gives red color to the blood. So that pigment is not there in snail. There is another pigment, hemocyanin. So because of that hemocyanin, it is in blue color. Whereas the cockroach, absence of any pigment, no color pigments are found, so it is white in color. So the color of the blood is decided by the pigment present in the blood. So this is a general idea about the blood. Now let us see the functions performed by the different blood cells. And one more important thing about the blood is, an adult human will have 5 liters of blood. So this is the volume of blood in our body. But do all of us have 5 liters of blood? It depends upon our body weight. So we will be having around 8% of our body weight. That is the amount of blood we have in our body. So that the 5 liters, it is for a person who weighs around some 70 to 72 kilograms. So if that is the weight of the person, he will be having 5 liters of blood. If your weight is less, you can calculate how much amount of blood is there in your body by taking that 8% of your body weight. That is the volume of blood present in your body. Okay, so now first we'll talk about RBC. So we are going to discuss about the cellular part of the blood. So the first one is RBC, red blood cells. These cells are also called as erythrocytes. Erythrocytes. So these are the disc-shaped cells compressed at the middle part on both sides. If you see the cell from side, it looks like this. So there is a compression, they are concave shape at the center. So these cells, they do not have a nucleus, and they are red in color because of the pigment hemoglobin. So hemoglobin is the pigment which is red in color, and it is a key substance which binds oxygen and transports it. So red blood cells are able to transport oxygen to different parts because of the hemoglobin. The hemoglobin is having that oxygen affinity, oxygen binding nature. So it binds the oxygen, it carries the oxygen to different parts of our body. So these red blood cells, if you take 1 ml of blood, you will find 5 million of red blood cells. That is the size of the red blood cell. So if you take 1 ml of blood, you will find 5 million of RBC. They are very small. And each RBC live for 120 days. That is the lifespan of RBC. So after the formation of the RBC, it will live in your blood for 120 days. So if all the RBC die in 120 days, then what happens to our blood? So every day, every minute, every second, new RBC are formed in our body. So the formation of RBC, where does it take place? From where the new red blood cells are formed. In which organ the formation of RBC takes place? So that is in the bone marrow. The bone marrow of long bones, say your thigh bones, femur. It's the largest bone. Inside that bone marrow, the formation of RBC takes place. So, for the formation of RBC, the process is called as erythropoiesis. So, for this erythropoiesis, a hormone is required which is produced in the kidneys. That hormone is erythropoietin. So, erythropoietin helps in erythropoiesis. What is erythropoiesis? Formation of RBC in the bone marrow. So, once these RBC are formed in the bone marrow, they are sent into the circulation, blood circulatory system, and they live for 120 days. And in this 120 days, they transport the oxygen from the respiratory organs to different parts of the body, and even they carry the carbon dioxide also to the exhalation or excretion. Once the life of an RBC is completed, what happens to that red blood cells? RBC, they break down, they are destroyed. At which place they are destroyed? So they are produced in the bone marrow. Where they are destroyed? They are destroyed in the spleen of our body. Spleen. So inside the spleen, the RBC is destroyed, and the iron present in the hemoglobin. Hemoglobin, it contains iron. So this iron present in the hemoglobin is collected back in the spleen. So the destruction of RBC takes place in the spleen. Because of that reason, the spleen is called as a graveyard. So graveyard of RBC. This is called as graveyard of RBC. Because the destruction of RBC takes place in the spleen. Formation takes place in the bone marrow. The destruction of RBC takes place in the spleen. So the formation of RBC, we learned that takes place in bone marrow. But in some cases, like in that early embryonic stages, when the babies are in the mother's womb, at that stage, the RBC are produced in the liver or spleen. So from the liver, they are produced. And all the RBC, the mammal RBC, are enucleated, no nucleus. So there is no nucleus. Here I have drawn a cell, there is no nucleus. They are enucleated, except some animals like camels. Camels, even though they are mammals, their RBC are nucleated. And ulama is also a camel-like animal which is having nucleus in their RBC. But except those two animals, rest of the mammals, they do not have a nucleus in their RBC. So this is all about the red blood cells or erythrocytes. Now, let us discuss about white blood cells or WBC. Okay, WBC or white blood cells. So these white blood cells are also called as leukocytes. They do not have any pigment like RBC. RBC, it has got hemoglobin. So because of the hemoglobin, it is having a specific color, red color. These WBC, they do not have any pigment, so they do not have any color. So that is the reason why they are called as leukocytes or white blood cells. So these leukocytes are of different types. They are divided to two major categories, granulocytes and agranulocytes. Granulocytes and agranulocytes. So again, these granulocytes are of three types: acidophils, basophils, and neutrophils. And agranulocytes are of two types: lymphocytes and monocytes. So these are the different categories. So finally, here we have five types of WBC: acidophils, basophils, neutrophils, lymphocytes, and monocytes. Now let us discuss about their functions. Now let us look at the functions of WBC. So the functions of WBC. The major function is defense. That is to protect our body from foreign organisms or pathogens, virus, bacteria, whatever. So different kind of organisms, foreign organisms or particles, they enter our body. So these white blood cells, they play a vital role in detoxifying them. That is, these WBC, they fight against the microorganisms. Mostly the granulocytes like eosinophils, basophils or neutrophils, they fight against the microorganisms. They kill the microorganisms. Sometimes even they die to neutralize or to kill the microorganisms. So that is the major role of the WBC. So they are in the defense nature. They are like policemen of our body. So if we see the granulocytes like lymphocytes, these lymphocytes, they produce some microscopic policemen. They're called as microscopic policemen of our body. They are the antibodies. So these antibodies are the special substances which bind to the foreign particles, maybe a virus or a bacteria or any other foreign substance. These antibodies, they bind to them and it neutralizes their activity. Otherwise, they may destroy our cells. They may use our cell or DNA or RNA of our cell and they may grow in number inside of our body. So that is prevented by these antibodies. So these antibodies, they bind to the foreign particles and they deactivate their activities. So they destroy their activities. They neutralize their activities. So that is the function done by the lymphocytes. So lymphocytes are very, very important in maintaining the immunity of our body. So these cells malfunction, do not function properly in cases like HIV. So the person who is infected with HIV, there will be a problem with the lymphocytes which are not able to produce proper antibodies to stop the activity of the foreign pathogens, that is the disease-causing organisms. So they become vulnerable to different diseases. So that is the condition. So the immunity is provided by these lymphocytes mainly, and monocytes. These monocytes are like some amoeba. You know amoeba, how it moves. So these are the amoeboid cells which move in our body and they engulf the foreign particles or pathogens. They engulf, they swallow up, they eat up the microorganisms and they digest them. So these monocytes are also called as scavengers of our body. So they keep the blood clean, they remove the dead bodies or the microorganisms or whatever, so, and they are called as scavengers of our body. So when there is an wound, there is a wound or a scar or a lesion on our skin, we find some pus coming out of it. So the pus is nothing but the activity of the white blood cells. The white blood cells, they carry out that defense process. So by that, it results to the formation of the pus. So this is the main or important function of the WBC, that is the defense, providing that immunity, self-defense strength of our body. The next important part of the blood cells, that is platelets. Platelets, they help in the process of blood clotting. So if this is the blood vessel, the blood is flowing like a stream. If there is any cut, so the blood may go out like this. So when the blood is flowing in the blood vessel, if there is a cut, the platelets, they come and they block the passage. So these platelets are joined together and a clot is formed by another substance present in the plasma. We already discussed, that is the heparin. So this material, it initiates the process of blood clotting. So the blood clotting is a deep mechanism that takes place, and here the platelets, they block the passage and they create a clot and prevent the outflow of the blood. So platelets help in blood clotting. So these are the different parts of the blood. We studied about plasma and the cellular part. The cellular part is having three different parts: red blood cells, white blood cells, and platelets. So red blood cells, major role is to transport the oxygen and carbon dioxide and white blood cells. They play an important role in immunity, that is protection, self-defense system of our body, and platelets help in blood clotting. So this is all about the blood. The another important part of the blood that what we are going to learn now, that is the blood groups. So the humans are categorized according to the blood groups. You might have heard about blood group test. You might have seen some advertisements or flash news. O group blood is required. A group blood is required, or AB positive blood is required. So the blood of humans is categorized into groups like A, B, O, AB. So what is this grouping? How this grouping is done? So let us see.